Okay, good morning, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Too loud, too soft? Okay, we had a little bit of confusion on our end apparently about the class schedule, but that's okay, we're just going to move forward. The slides that I have are actually for two chapters. I think we'll probably only cover the one chapter, chapter three today, and save chapter four for next time. So probably we'll go ahead. Ken, is there anything that you want to say at this point before I start? Okay. All right. So to remind you just a little bit, we've been discussing media and culture. Last week we talked particularly about theories and methods of understanding media. To remind you, a theory we use it a lot in academic settings. The idea of theory. For our purposes, a theory is basically a very organized, formal way of thinking about the world. It's a set of ideas that helps you understand how the world works, helps you to interpret the world around you, and helps you to make predictions about things that will happen. Having theories about media, and particularly media effects, which is what we've been focusing on, is useful in that it helps us to have a sense of how it is that mass media can have an impact on society, and how people can have an impact back on mass media. Keep in mind this Clay Shirky video that we watched the very first week of class. And if you haven't seen that, please do make sure you watch it. I do recommend you watch it a few times over the course of the semester, because I'll be organizing many of the ideas from the lectures around the general argument that Shirky was making in that short lecture, and I think that lecture is very useful for developing ways to think about media technologies and to think about how people interact with media technologies. And Shirky is particularly concerned with how politics and political activism are managed happen through mass media technologies. So I think it's a very useful video. Now what we're going to turn to for the course is many mass media texts take this approach of sort of going through historical eras, through the development of different mass media technologies, and so we'll follow this approach as well. As we talk about the various mass media technologies that are relevant to the course, I'd like you to try to imagine at each step, with each chapter that we look at, try to imagine, just for the sake of understanding the trajectory of development of mass media, try to imagine a world in which the mass media that we have now do not exist. A world in which each of these technologies that we talk about is a new introduction and a new level of media, a new technology that creates opportunities for new ways for people to communicate with one another. Okay, so okay, so our first chapter, our first step into a technology is with books. Of course, we're all familiar with books. Maybe some of us less so than we might have been at a certain point in our lives, given the proliferation of new technologies at this point. Less than a 2004 study, now keep in mind 2004, this is 12 years ago, the National Endowment for the Arts in the United States, now National Endowment for Arts is an organization concerned very much with literature, fine arts, and that sort of thing. They did a study showing less than 50% of the population in the United States was reading literary works. They found the greatest decline was among young people. In 1984, a study they did in 1984 showed that young people were the people most likely to be reading literary books. And in 2002 and in 2004, young people had gone to being the least likely to be reading literary works. This is a concern for this organization and for our understanding of the development of culture as a whole. They launched a campaign as a response to this study. They launched a campaign in 2006 and. In going through that campaign and again doing their study, they found that the levels of young people reading had recovered, and the greatest gains were among youth. Now, one of the issues in this change was that in conducting the later study, the NEA no longer limited themselves just to who had read a printed book, but also included e-books in their statistics. We have to keep in mind, in this chapter, when we're talking about books, we begin by talking about actual printed works, physical works. Our understanding of books now is changing. I live in Kazakhstan now. I'm far away from easy, cheap access to books in English through libraries. And so even though I prefer printed books, I'm doing lots and lots of reading with e-books right now. Our behavior, our understanding of what a book is, has changed. We no longer think of books necessarily as printed reading matter. When we think of books, we may think of electronic reading matter that's presented in a particular format or has a particular length, particular characteristics. So our understanding of even of what a particular technology is somewhat flexible, somewhat responsive to our to the things that are available to us, to the environment in which we're operating. Some of the key issues coming out of this research, got questions about how it is that we measure literary reading. Do we do it through reader surveys, publisher statistics? It's not necessarily an easy thing to measure the amount of reading that people in society are doing. And these are methodological questions. We talked about methodology last week. How do you investigate? How do you discover? How do you measure the phenomena that you're trying to understand? Those are kinds of questions that we need to address. There's the question of how we define what books are, what reading material are. We now operate in an environment in which many people are reading the same words they might have read 20 years ago in a printed book, but they're reading them in electronic format. So there's a question about what we call a book and what we call something else. The way we go about doing research, the methodologies that we use, can have a big, big impact on the results that we achieve and on how we interpret those results. So I think the lesson from this series of NEA studies is that we have to understand those changes and adapt to them as we interpret our examinations of media. I have lots and lots of books around my office here. This is one that belongs to one of my children. Books, let's talk a little bit about the history of the development of the technologies behind books. Egyptians had, in ancient Egypt, there was writing developed on various types of materials. Around 3000 BC, the Egyptians were using combinations of metal, leather, clay, stone, bone, papyrus, and with these materials, you can see attempts to gather and store information in ways that allow for transportable information, collections of information. This is sort of the earliest that we see of development of our idea of what a book is. But still very, very far from the objects that we have as books today. Around 500 BC, writing on papyrus was the dominant method of written communication, and Egypt had was the primary producer of papyrus. They dominated papyrus trade, which gave them put them in a very influential position in the development of technologies of writing. The development of parchment from animal skins and bound books was something that was contributed by the Roman Empire to the development of books. Parchment from animal skins was more durable than the papyrus that the Egyptians used, and the development of bindings that would keep pages of parchment together was something that changed the possibility of having more information together, which was a big step in books. The spread of Christianity, and particularly the importance of religious texts, was very important in the development and of books, and helped spread the use, helped spread the development of writing. Around 700 BC, block printing on paper was developed in China by the Tang Dynasty. Block printing is a process in which a block of a carved block is used with ink to create an impression on a piece of paper, parchment, whatever you're printing on. Previous to that, before the development of block printing, in order to create a text, someone would have to individually write on individual pages. So the development of block printing, of creating impressions on a page, was an important development in making print communication a little bit more of a mass medium. Right? There's a big difference between having printed works that are individually inscribed, written by individual people, which takes a lot of time and is very time consuming, laborious process. No matter how hard you try to duplicate something, each thing may be a little bit different. The creation of block printing allows for duplication of materials, and not yet mass production, but production of a number of copies of a piece of material. This technology of block printing, it developed, as I said, 700 AD in China. It wasn't until 600 years later that this technology came to Europe, about 100 AD. So the Chinese were quite far ahead of the West in developing print technologies in this period. In Europe, as book production developed, book production was dominated by monasteries, religious groups. Religious groups were very concerned about spreading their word, in this case, Christianity and the Bible. Books in this period became handcrafted works of art and artisany. In other words, a book would take a very long time to create. Each individual book would take a very long time to create. If any of you have ever seen, perhaps in museums or archives, the earliest books, the books that were developed prior to printing presses, they're oftentimes very ornate, very carefully crafted works of art, actually, which suggests the amount of attention and detail put into them. It also suggests books were items of luxury, something that required so much labor to produce was not accessible to much of the population. This is the early production of books was very, very limited to elites in society. There's a video here that I'd like you to watch. I'm sorry, I'll post right now the URL for you. Okay, I posted that, whoops, there's a previous message there, let me post it again. Okay, I posted the URL, please copy and paste that into your browser and take a couple minutes to watch that video. Okay, thank you very much. So this ad, it's a cultural commentary on the process, the labor-intensive process of creation of books. I think it's actually a very, it's a very interesting ad. It came out in the mid-1970s, at a time when technology, duplication technologies were developing very rapidly. So what they're advertising here is photocopiers. Now, at the time this ad came out, I remember I was in school in the late 1970s, and I remember the transition that schools went through from mimeograph technologies. Previous to this, in order to duplicate large numbers of papers, schools had machines that were essentially a stencil with ink, which would go around a cylinder. And in order to duplicate large numbers of papers, teachers would have to either type or hand draw on a special stencil, and then put it in this machine, and it would spin around. You could put ink in it; it would spin around and around, and pump out many copies of wet ink-laden pieces of paper in duplicate. So when photocopying technology that allowed essentially a machine to take a photo of a page and then duplicate it in dry copy and much faster than the mimeograph, this was a big technological advance. Well, from a cultural perspective and from a commercial perspective, very interesting for Xerox Company, the Xerox Corporation, a company that was at the forefront, at that point at the forefront of developing duplication technologies. And they had, at this point in the 1970s, they were starting to mass market not just photocopiers, but photocopiers that could do collation and this sort of thing. So very interesting, I think, for this company to have produced an advertisement looking back at the process, the laborious individual process of creating books that was at work in the early era of books. And of course, the setting here is a monastery, a monk who spends his time laboriously copying texts. And you see the idea is it took him a lot of time to copy one text, and when he's asked to produce 500, it's a miracle that the Xerox company has developed technology that can help him do this. Anyhow, I think these kinds of advertisements can help us to try to get some kind of a perspective on the shifts, the major shifts that happen with the development of new technology. So some of the key pieces that went into the development of the book, and I think they're interesting because there are different developments that are being done in different places at different times, and they start to come together. When they come together, that's when we're able to develop something closer to the modern book, which had a huge role in modernization in Europe. So paper was crucial to the development of the modern book. Paper had been used for centuries already in China and the Islamic world, and only came to Europe in the 14th century, the 1300s. Now, paper which is made with processed wood is much more durable, much more long-lasting than either papyrus or parchment, both of which are more susceptible to rotting and decay. So this has and it's lighter, more transportable. So this was an important, a very important step in the development of the modern book was the development of paper made with processed wood pulp. In 1448, the development of the Gutenberg press made book production much less expensive. It made it standardized, and it started to make it commercially viable. The Gutenberg press is a printing press that allows for setting of typeface in a frame, which can be pressed on paper individually. So the Gutenberg press was a step beyond the kind of press technologies, press printing technologies that we saw in China. It didn't require an entire plate to be recast for every new impression. It allowed for placement of individual letters in a frame that could be pressed on pieces of paper, and this made it possible to produce far more quickly and to produce the original of the frame, and made it and the frame was longer lasting, could produce far more impressions than carved press technologies. So this was a huge step in the development of the book. This contributed to increased numbers of books being available in society. The cost of producing texts went down. So this was a period in the mid-1400s and beyond. This was a period, there was still a focus on producing religious texts quite a bit, although other kinds of texts also began to produce. But the increased presence of texts contributed to increased spread of ideas and increased opportunity for the development of literacy. If people don't have access to written material, they have no way to learn to read and write. So once publishing technologies improved, there were far more books produced, and the presence of books helps to spur education, spur growth of libraries, spread literacy, and so on. So this was a very important role of publishing. The commercial production of books helped in the development of the idea of individual authorship. Think of it this way: prior to production of the printed word, there was less of a concern with individual authorship. Ideas would often be spread through through face-to-face communication, discussion, discourse, and the idea of authorship was less prominent. It's with the development of the printed book that our idea of authorship and the importance of individual authors really takes hold in society. And this is the era in which the idea of copyright, legal protection for written works, also developed. Copyright developed both as a concept that would help control what was published. In other words, particularly in Britain, the development of copyright was a form of ensuring that government had authority to confirm publications, to authorize publications and disauthorize publications. But copyright also developed as a way to promote production of works, to encourage people to produce works by protecting those works and ensuring that authors knew that, for instance, if they produced a book that they would have some legal protection from other people coming and reproducing it without their permission. Okay, let's think about a little bit about books as mass media. The idea of mass media, excuse me. I'll refer you back to Shirky's video now. Remember when Shirky talked about the dominant mass media in the 20th century, print technologies, broadcast, recorded technologies, and conversational technologies like telephone and telegraph. A mass medium is a medium that allows somebody communicating through that medium to reach many people simultaneously. Before books could be produced as a mass medium, they didn't have the same social impact they did. Once books could be produced en masse, many, many copies and distributed to many people, they could be much more effective as pieces of information that would help to organize our thinking in society. A single book reproduced a few times is a limited media text. It's like a letter. It's like a letter that you handwrite to somebody. Consider this. How many people could you reach handwriting individual letters? A single book reproduced many times and distributed to a wide audience becomes a mass media text. It becomes a text that allows us to reach many, many people with the same message. We're going forward a little bit here. There are many examples. books in the 19th and 20th centuries that were very influential in American culture. So they come from different eras. Now this, the examples here, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Uncle Tom's Cabin was a novel that was written during the time in which slavery was institutionalized in the United States. And it was a text that was very influential in drawing attention of many people to the impact of slavery in society. It's one that many students who study American history and the history of slavery in the United States are familiar with that book and the influence that book had on raising concerns of people about slavery. The Wizard of Oz was a series of books actually by a writer named Frank Baum, which was influential in the early 1900s, and was the source for a movie by the same name, The Wizard of Oz, which has had an international impact. Howl is a book of poetry by a beat poet, Allen Ginsberg. These are just a few examples of books in the United States that have had major impact, and I think if we think about it, many of us can identify books that we know about. We may or may not have read them, but books that we know about that have had a huge cultural impact in society. You can be exposed to the ideas from a book whether you read it or not. When books become very influential in society, the ideas that come from a book may be discussed, they may appear in other places. They can have an impact even beyond the audience of people who actually read the book, for better or for worse. Often the most influential books touch some kind of a nerve related to issues of cultural concern. And this is not something that's limited to books, of course, but it is something that helps us identify influential works. Okay, I have a couple of thought questions that I would like you to consider. The first one is, Clay Shirky described 20th century books and printing as good for creating groups rather than for creating conversations. Why do you think this might be? Take a minute or two. What I'd like you to do is talk to people in the group there in your computer lab and come up with a few ideas about why it is that 20th century books may be better for creating groups rather than for creating conversations. And tell me also, so consider these three questions. Would pre-Gutenberg books, in other words, the books that are created by hand, the books that are works of artisany that take a long time to produce, would those kind of books be better, more useful for creating groups or for creating conversations? And why might that be? And the third question I'd like you to deal with right now, what kind of books can you identify that have been widely influential in Korea? How are they culturally significant? And are there books that you can think of that you feel like you know something about the book, you've been affected by it, even if you haven't read it? So I'll give you a few minutes to think about that idea, and then post a few thoughts in the chat group, please. And I'll be back in just a couple of minutes.
Thank you. mean.
My throat is starting to really give out for some reason, so is it possible maybe around, I'll probably finish around 20 after, so if it's possible, maybe you can show portions of that video then?
Yeah, I can do that, plus I, listening to your presentation, I have a PowerPoint of where I kind of take him a tour of a newspaper site, but also a lot of emphasis on the press.
Mm-hmm.
So I could maybe first do that, kind of follow up on what you're talking about now.
Okay.
And I was thinking back, you're talking about when I bought my first newspaper, it came with a press with removable type, metal type, for doing invitations and stuff like that. I mean, they didn't use it for the newspaper, but they used it for their special printing, and I immediately got rid of it. And even when, in 1986, when I started my first, or when I went to work for the daily newspaper, they were still using plates that were made with kind of plastic and still had raised lettering in 1986.
Yeah.
So you're really not that much changing from Gutenberg to 1986 and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
In lots of ways.
Okay. I'm not sure if they're going to get. They're not actually posting any responses.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
Pulling teeth with them.
Okay.
Okay. When you're, I'm listening in, so.
Okay. So
when you're done, give me a 10-minute break and I'll take over.
Okay.
Okay, why don't we, you know, we can give people some more time. I think Cici Chin is making some really, really good points here. I'd like to underscore that. Okay, Shamrock, also good point. Books are a way to get exposure to something you may not otherwise have easy access to. Books can be things you learn from. They can be ways to learn about the world far beyond what you're able to see yourself. And this is one of the key features of media in general, but particularly of mass media, is mass media expose us to something bigger. I'd like to underscore also Cici Chin's ideas. The groups that Shirky talks about, the creation of groups, is less through direct exposure to other people than it is through exposure to common sets of information, common pieces of information. So in 20th century media, the creation of groups, as Cici Chin put it, it's indirect. It's not so much through direct connections to other people in your community as it is to direct connection to centralized sources of information in your community. I think this is an important element of understanding mass culture and mass society, that a culture, a society built around mass media is one in which we may understand ourselves as sharing identity, being part of the same group of people we will never meet, never see. Think of cities. In a city, we never see most of the people in the city, even though we understand ourselves as part of that. I'm very happy with the responses that you've given here. Unfortunately, the medium through which we're working right now doesn't give us as much opportunity for conversations as I would like. So I want us to find some ways of promoting these conversations through the Facebook group. I'll encourage you, if you haven't had a chance to post in the chat box here, or if you haven't, if ideas occur to you later on, please post into the Facebook group or the Facebook page for further discussion. Modern book formats. We've got a variety of formats that we use for books right now. Let me see. We've got what we call I won't pick up the books that we call soft cover books, the ones with the paper cover, paperbacks, hard cover books. Hard cover books tend to be expensive, enduring, durable. They're often used for new releases of books or for classics, things like that. Paperbacks. Paperbacks are inexpensive, disposable, secondary releases. There was a period in World War II in the United States when many, to an extent previously unprecedented, a large number of Americans throughout society were overseas fighting and in the war, and there developed during that period a paperback format. I have an example here, just a moment. Very small, this is an example of a small format paperback book. They developed during that period small format paperback books that soldiers could easily pack and carry with them. They were cheap, relatively disposable. If you lost it, it didn't represent a lot of money. The formats, the changing formats of books are often responsive to particular cultural concerns, cultural needs. In the United States now, there's been a move in publishing away from these smaller format paperback books, which were, when I was growing up, those small format paperbacks were very dominant. And now there's been a move in the last 15 years or so to larger format, what are called trade paperbacks, that are bigger formats and more similar to, they're like hardcover books with a soft cover rather than like very small transportable books. So I think it's interesting to consider the various factors that go into different formats of books and potentially very very interesting field of research or topic for research to consider the different ways that the different formats in which books have been published. E-books have become huge recently, and now e-book sales are outpacing hard format books in the publishing industry. E-books are ephemeral, lightweight. They present competing formats with hard copy books. This question, I'd like you to think about your own use of books, and rather than, we won't deal with this question right now, but please, for the Facebook group, I'm curious which formats of books you prefer. I know many students here, I had some students here do a presentation on books and formats of books, and the students expressed that they felt like they could very easily switch from one format of book to another. It was for some of the students it was just the content of what they were reading that was important and not the format itself. Other students expressed strong preference. Some people really preferred e-book formats, which they felt like they could take with them anywhere. Others really liked the feel of and the look of hardcover books and the ability that they had to scan through them quickly and that sort of thing. So I would like to hear from you in the Facebook group about different formats of books that you prefer and why. Modern bookselling has developed into a phenomenon that's subject to, it's what we call the blockbuster syndrome. The publishing industries tend to focus on finding bestsellers and selling many copies of a few books. Think of the if you've heard, I'm sure, of the Harry Potter series of books that was wildly popular for a generation of kids growing up. There's now a whole generation in North America, a whole generation of young people who identify themselves very closely with the Harry Potter books. Think of the Hunger Games. These are works that focus on getting that publishers use to focus a lot of attention on a few books. For many people, this means that a few books, a few authors get lots of attention, lots of notoriety, lots of resources, and many other authors who produce books that are just as good, but not so well known, are left without the financial rewards that the blockbuster books get. And there's a concern that this is somehow impoverishing the publishing industry and making us, giving us fewer important works on from which to learn. Another phenomenon that's been happening in publishing has been the growth of superstores, large booksellers, first large booksellers, physical booksellers, but now even those large physical booksellers are being pushed out by online booksellers. There's been a tendency towards concentration in the bookselling markets, so that small bookstores and small booksellers are not able to survive. For many people, this is a phenomenon that impoverishes us by reducing the range of different voices and the opportunities that we have to engage with other people around books. Finally, digitization. Digitization has been had a huge impact on books, as with other communication industries. Oprah Winfrey in her talk show mentioned the Kindle, which is the Amazon company's proprietary tablet ebook reader. And when she mentioned that in 2008, it really sparked sales of tablets, and now public libraries in the United States and worldwide are not just dealing in physical books, physical reading material, but are also loaning out electronic books to their patrons. There's a project, it's called Project Gutenberg, which is attempting to digitize many books and make them available to people online. This is met with some resistance from copyright holders, and there's been much negotiation over how to balance the interests of society as a whole in having access to works online and how to protect the interests of copyright holders to ensure that they're properly compensated for their work. There's also been a huge growth in self-publishing, development of personal computers, publishing software, and inexpensive printers that can print and bind pages quickly, means there's actually been some growth of people who are self-publishing works. And I know, for instance, I had a teacher in high school who has now self-published a book and made it available both as an ebook and as a printed text, made it available online. He's certainly not selling, not doing any blockbuster selling, but he is selling copies of his book and making some money from it. The opportunity now that people have to publish individually has greatly increased, even as our technologies have made it more and more possible for development of blockbusters and dominance by a few people and a few texts. Okay. That's all I want to say about books for right now. I want to thank you for the comments that you made in the chat. They were very helpful. I do encourage you to make similar comments, answer questions in the Facebook group. We'll take now a 10-minute break, and when we come back, Ken will pick things up. I'll see you again next week as we turn to newspapers. I believe Ken may what Ken talks about today may serve as a transition to that. So I want to thank you very much for your time, and have a very good week. Say, Ian, I'm sorry, I think I forgot to send you the files from last week, unless Ken did it. I'll send you both files from last week and this week in a few minutes. Okay. Have a very good week, everybody, and I'll see you next week. 10-minute break, please, and then Ken will come online. So long.
Okay, can you hear me okay? I'm trying not to have to hold up my microphone. I'm going to sit it here on the desk if possible. Can you hear me okay? Okay, good. My own background, as I may have mentioned before, is in publishing. I usually consider myself more of a newspaper publisher. But I also have experience as a book editor, author, and publisher. For example, I'm going to try to take you to a couple of websites here real quick. Let me see how this works. Something we don't use very often here. But let me see. Hopefully you can see what I'm showing you. I can't get your, I can't see your responses, but regardless, I'm going to go ahead and talk my way through it, even if you can't see it. There are many types of books. This is one type of book that I've published hundreds of. It's not for resale. It's not a retail book. It's a promotional book. I printed hundreds of books, published hundreds of books on behalf of engineering firms to very specifically promote their services and their expertise to individual contractors. These jobs might be to design the architectural, do the architectural, civil design, architectural design, structural design, civil design, everything related to a school, for example. If you're seeing this image, hopefully you are, the top image is of a school. A laboratory underneath it to the left, an office building underneath it to the right, a laboratory underneath that, and so forth. These are buildings that the company I worked with, SEM Consultants, designed. So when they went after a million-dollar job like this, they would have me publish a book on their behalf to tell their story, and each book was customized to the potential contractor. On the other hand, I also published books for charitable purposes. I was a co-founder of this project called Insights into Development that has now published, I can't remember whether it's 5 or 6 books, one book annually. I co-author and publish this for this project. It's about best practices in the world of nonprofit organizations, non-government organizations. And so this is another type of book that somebody might publish. On the other hand, I've also authored and published, I was going to bring up the bigger picture of this, but this is kind of the management system of Amazon, where I authored a book called The Story of Jesus, the religious book, and Amazon sells it for me. Since it's simply an ebook, as Frederick was talking about, it doesn't cost very much. It's a book of about 150 pages. I don't remember exactly how long it is, and it only sells for about $5. So I'm an ebook publisher, but companies like Amazon and Barnes and Noble will sell these on our behalf. So this facilitates people becoming ebook publishers. Because even these big organizations like Amazon will handle the sales for us. So I'll go back. Let me see if you were able to see that. Let me open up this. So. Were you able to see those websites when I opened them up? Okay. That's interesting, because as I said earlier, you should all be receiving the same signal on this system. So I don't know why some computers would receive it and others would not. Because all of you have access to the same signal. You might want to have your technical people check your computers to see why some computers would not be receiving it. That doesn't make sense. In going to that desktop view, my own webcam is not showing up for me. So let me see what I need to do. Let me go to just go to the chat. So we do, you can see me right now, because I can't see me right now for some reason. It may not matter if I'm going to go to the presentation anyway. let me go to the presentation and see if you can see that. It doesn't really matter whether you can see my webcam right now, if you can, if most of you can hear me. And if you can, okay, the desktop function seems to have screwed up some things on my part even, on my half. I'm going to go back here a second. I didn't hit stop. That was my fault. Okay, now I've hit stop on the desktop, and now I'll go back to the presentation I was going to give. Okay, so what can you see now? You should be able to see my webcam and the PowerPoint now. You cannot see my, not that it really matters too much, but it just annoying how the system is working. Can you now see my webcam? Okay. Okay, well, that's what you should be able to see. So, good. So anyway, there's different types of books that just different, you might say different genre of books, and it's not all for retail, it's not all for sale. There are different purposes for books that are very important. As I mentioned, the promotional books that I prepared for the engineering firm, I maybe only prepared a few copies of the book, but they could win a contract worth $1 million or more. So they were rather important books. It could make somebody, they can make that company a lot of money. The charitable books, the books for the Insights Project, could, on the other hand, help promote the good works of nonprofit, non-government organizations. They could help promote the best practices and help those organizations do a better job, and so forth. If you can only see the presentation, that's fine. I don't know why that's true, but if you can only see the presentation, at least you see the presentation. So some of this is a little bit redundant to what Frederick was saying, but maybe kind of expands on it. The book selling is moving online. Brick and mortar bookstores are disappearing. Reading is moving to screens as ebooks replace print books. New publishing and distribution tools empower authors to become professional publishers while eroding, kind of contrary to what Frederick was saying, this movement towards self-publishing, facilitated by big companies like Amazon, is eroding the monopolistic edge once held by the large publishers. This next slide kind of illustrates that, I believe. So this is ebooks as a percentage of U.S. wholesale, and this is only as of 2010, and it's moving very rapidly. So this is an actual sale. So there's lots of people that write ebooks and nobody ever reads them. I don't have a lot of sales with that book I put on Amazon. I haven't. When you publish your own book, Amazon tries to help promote it, but it is also selling, you know, tens of thousands of other books. And so their main job is not promoting my book. Now, they do give me some ways that I can help promote it myself, but I haven't made a lot of sales on my Amazon book. And so this chart isn't about how many books are published, because I would say most books now are ebooks, but most ebooks do not get a lot of sales, do not get a lot of distribution. And in some cases, they don't even want a lot of distribution. They don't care. They're not anticipating a lot of distribution. They want to, for example, the charitable books, they're not for sale. I'm not trying to sell them. It's a charitable, trying to promote a charitable good works and good practices. So we're not trying to sell those books. And so there's a lot of those that are now being published as ebooks because it doesn't cost anything. And it has a lot of benefit to a lot of people. So that wouldn't show up on this chart. But even as of 2010, ebooks represented 20% of the entire trade in the U.S. And you see how quickly, how much it grew just in that last year in 2010. I think, I don't know, maybe the last one might be 2011. I'm not sure what year represents the last green box there. But between 2011 and 2016, that trend is increasing dramatically, as the trend line would suggest here. So I don't know, I don't have the latest figures, but ebooks are becoming more and more popular, undoubtedly. And so once you say that, then you're saying really self-publishing is becoming more popular. I mentioned I was also getting involved in I'm not really going into detail on this, but Amazon actually doesn't sell in Kazakhstan. There are a number of companies, Western companies, that don't quite trust the Kazakhstan market. So I was working with a company to try to get around that a little bit, or with an organization. But I'm going to skip that subject right now. We have, I hit the wrong button, so I went way too far. Okay, there. I'll go back to where I wanted to be. So future trends certainly look like, there's going to be more digital distribution, which will enable authors and publishers to efficiently, reach a global market. Obviously, it's easier to ship an ebook around the world than it is a hardcover book. There is definitely an oversupply of books, and alternative media content will place downward pressure on ebook prices. So ebooks will cost less. I'm not sure what impact it will have. I mean, some books will never be printed. A lot of books will never be printed now because they will come out as ebooks. I'm doing an ebook right now that should be out within the next month or so. And it's called The Mobile Marketing Unveiling the Secrets. It's going to be only about, I don't know exactly, I'm just finishing it, maybe 35 or 40 pages, not real long. But as I say in my introduction to it, the purpose of it is to teach people how to do online marketing, but teach them in a very, very specific step-by-step way. People want to use the information I'm going to give to them very quickly and be able to start implementing it the very same day. Along with it will come a 1 hour, actually will come about 4 hours of video training, including a 1 hour overview of the book itself, and then additional videos for training some of the skills talked about in the book. So now this has become basically a multimedia book. So that's one difference. One thing that's different about ebooks is they can be multimedia, if not directly within the book, which is possible, but at least have links to other multimedia elements. And I was explaining in my introduction to this book why putting this out as an ebook is important. Last year, starting about a year exactly, well, about 13 months ago, around the first of 2015, I started writing a traditional book, a book that's going to be printed. And it's about the impact of new technologies, internet and mobile, especially mobile, on all aspects of society. My chapters were about journalism, advertising, marketing, education, public relations, and so forth. I co-authored 7 chapters. As I got done writing my last chapter last October, I had a very rude aha experience. I realized that the chapters I had finished in May were already out of date. Things are changing so quickly in technology, and the impact of technology is having such a rapid and dramatic effect on these different areas, particularly marketing and advertising and PR, that my chapters within 6 months were already out of date. And because it's a printed book and the process for going to press is it takes, you know, you have a lot of editing to do and page setup and all the things that go into a printed book. That book is not yet printed. My ebook that I'm still writing, but hope to finish by April 1st, my ebook will go to market before the traditional book that I wrote last year. And the ebook will be more up to date than the traditional book. The traditional book, as soon as it's published, will be out of date. It's already out of date, and it's not been published yet. My ebook, I've promised my readers that I will update it at least every 3 months. And so at some point, if they want to buy the book again, the book a year from now will be revised and be very different than the book that will go on the market next month. Because that it has to change in order to keep up with the dramatic changes in technology and its impact on these areas of society, marketing and advertising and so forth. So ebooks have a very important purpose, and the textbook that I wrote last year, I'm very frustrated about because upon being published, it will already be out of date. So anyway, ebooks are an interesting phenomenon and an important phenomenon in our society today. There is what we call author 2.0. Author 2.0 is an author who's handling more basically self-publishing. So it's about you and your book reaching a global audience on your terms, as it says here. So this is the new type of book publishing. If you take on this, you suddenly take on a lot of different roles. If you really are taking it seriously, you're not just writing the book. Before, you wrote the book, you gave it to the publisher, they did some editing and maybe asked you to do some rewriting, but basically your only job in author 1.0 was to write the book, was to be the author. In author 2.0, you have to, you know, solicit book reviews. You have to use Amazon's marketing tools if you want to be successful. You have to go to book launches, perhaps, and develop your own marketing plan. You may need to create multimedia, audio and video of the book itself, or a promotional, make YouTube videos to help promote it. You need to be working on social networking and social media to help get this out. You're going to want to do blogging and maybe even share parts of your book in order to promote the entire book, the book in its entirety. Some ebooks are actually just a compilation of blogs. So you start off as a blogger and you start writing your book as a blogger, page by page, section by section. And then when you get all, you know, after you've blogged for about a year, you put it all together and say, this is my book. So you have to oversee if you're going to print. Just because you're an author 2.0 doesn't mean you don't print, because there are new types of publishers or new type of, they are publishers. So like Amazon could sell your book if they choose to, both as an ebook and as a printed book. I will talk in a second to show you a slide about another company that specializes in that. They specialize in helping authors who are in the 2.0 mode to publish and promote their book as an ebook, but also upon demand, print a copy for anybody who wants a hard copy of it, wants a printed copy of it. So even if you are, if most of your sales are ebooks, you may still want to have the printed, have printed publishing as an option, and therefore you'd have to work with a publisher on preparing the printed version also. So being an author 2.0 is very different. And so this is kind of bringing together the new and old worlds, and there's kind of a bridging there. This is talking about some very popular ebook authors. Amanda Hawking has sold millions of books through Amazon. And then after she had sold millions of books on Amazon, then a traditional press said, hey, we want you to publish with us a traditional book. And so you know, they paid her $2.5 million to go ahead and move from an independent, being an independent 2.0 publisher, to go into traditional publishing. Basically the same sort of John Locke, on the other hand, was the first self-published author to sell 1 million books on Amazon. So he, again, he, you know, Amazon didn't come to him. He went to Amazon, he wrote his books, and they helped him market it, but he sold over 1 million books. So there's quite a few 2.0 authors who are doing very well. Lots of others are doing it more for a hobby than they are for a profession, you might say. But to understand what's happening, you need to understand these aspects of it. So again, I mentioned there's new print-on-demand pod technology that allows you to do both, to both be an ebook author and also then offer your book at a fairly reasonable price. It's kind of related, kind of like that Xerox commercial that Frederick was showing you, except it has just become inexpensive enough that it makes sense for a publisher, for some publishing companies, to go ahead and do this. And so they can take an ebook and they can make a printed copy and bind it and do everything that's necessary for somebody who wants the printed version and not charge an excessive amount. It used to be, in fact, in my newspaper publishing, and we're going to maybe go back to that just in a few minutes, but in my newspaper publishing, what I had to realize as a newspaper publisher was that the main cost of publishing a paper or a newspaper was the setup, getting it on the press and ready to go. And so, for example, I got a contract to publish a newspaper for a government agency. It was a bilingual newspaper in Spanish and English. Every story was in both languages, and it focused on education. And so this government agency paid me to produce this newspaper every 3 months. I had to kind of make a bid on that. I had to make a proposal, and I had to outbid another company that had been doing it for about 10 years. And what I understood that what my competitor did not really understand is that I could afford to offer this agency 4 times as many copies and still make a good profit, because the cost in printing, the other company was giving them 5,000 copies and I offered them 20,000 copies. And so when they looked at my bid and looked at his, and I also offered more pages. So he was offering, I think, 5,000 copies of only 12 pages. I offered them 20,000 copies and an average of about 18 pages. It'd be either 16 pages or 20 pages. And so it averaged out about 18 pages. And so my bid was accepted. Well, that was because I understood that printers, once they get my job on the press, then it doesn't cost that much more to add pages or to print 20,000 copies rather than 5,000 copies. So I still made a good profit, even though my bid was so outrageously better than the guy who had the bid for 10 years, 4 times as many copies and way, you know, 50% more pages. So the same was true in book publishing previously, is that it costs so much money to set up the printing of a book that you couldn't set it up with traditional presses and only print a few copies. And so it really depended on new technology bringing that price down to where it was reasonable to print 1 to 10 copies and not have to charge too much for it. And so this print-on-demand technology now makes that possible. So I can produce, and I intend to do that in the next couple of months, to produce a sequel to this one I'm going to offer just as an ebook, expand it a little bit, and offer it as both an ebook and as a print-on-demand book through a company that I'm going to introduce you to in a second. I already talked about the book I published with Insights into Development. This particular website here, I'm not going to bring it up, but it also was with a company that would offer the PLD, basically. They would, it was offered as an ebook. I could charge, but if I wanted to charge something as an ebook, I could. In this case, because it was a charitable book, I didn't charge anything for the ebook. But if somebody wanted the printed copy, they then would pay $10 for it, and I would get part of the profit. I would get, I think, 80%, and the publisher would get 20%, even in the printed copy. I think that was the split. It was not, they did not take that much for even printing a book and shipping it to somebody. So there are several companies that will do this. I'm not even sure this one, mybook.com, I'm not sure they still exist. I don't know. I haven't gone back to check them lately. I did check them, and it wasn't coming up right. So I think they may be out of business now. But it's a new approach to publishing. And I already talked about this book, so I'll skip over that. This is the book that I'm selling, for those that weren't able to see it. The book I'm selling through Amazon.com. So this is a book for retail. Anyway, some goals of mine for producing more ebooks and pod books, if you would. And I won't go into detail on that. There are, as I mentioned, a number of companies, Barnes & Noble, Amazon, that do work with Author 2.0s and doing ebooks and pod books. So these are just some of them. Amazon, for example, for their ebooks, they pay a 70% royalty. So they keep 30%. I get 70% of what the ebook sells for. Barnes & Noble, like I said, also does something similar. They just, if I sell a book, they put my version directly into my bank account. You do have to have a U.S. bank account, I think, Amazon is global, but not in Kazakhstan. So, and Barnes & Noble, when I made this PowerPoint anyway, you had to have a U.S. bank account. They might have expanded from that. Bookdesigners.com helps with print on demand. And all platforms, Smashwords.com. Pays an 85% royalty, and they help get you onto Amazon, help get you onto Barnes & Noble, plus they sell the books directly, and they do print on demand. And so my next book is going to go through Smashwords.com. They have done, I think, several hundred thousand books. They are becoming a major enterprise, and I'm going to try Smashwords as my primary publisher for my next book. We already talked about John Locke. One of the best-selling ebook authors and the one who shares most knowledge, a guy named Joe Conrath, who also has authored a book called Newbie's Guide to Publishing. If you're interested in ebook publishing, you can look up Joe Conrath. Digibook World is another ebook publishing. It's about ebook publishing news, so it gives you information about how to become a self-published author. Mark Coker is the creator of Smashwords, and he does a lot of, you can find him on YouTube and other locations where he talks about ebook publishing and so forth. So these are some resources for those that are interested in self-published authoring 2.0. Some tips that they give for being an author. And I think this is important for you to, if you ever think about, gee, I might want to try this, you have to realize that writing is work. all the publishing I've done, it is a lot of work. You have to go to work regularly. You have to set up a schedule. You have to decide when is best for you to work. For me, I work best at night. And so since I'm doing it in addition to being a professor, I usually don't come to work. I don't have classes till the afternoon except for this class when I here at, we start at 8 a.m. here with your class. But otherwise, my classes are in the afternoon. So I do my KEMEP classes in the afternoon, and then I stay in the evening and sometimes past 11 o'clock at night working on my books, my research and my books. And then I, you know, get up a little bit later in the morning. That's just, it's because I'm, in my career, I've done most of my work at night as a newspaper editor and journalist and, you know, reporter and so forth. A lot of my work was at night, and that's very typical of the newspaper schedule. And so that's still my best schedule now. And so you have to figure out when do you want to go to work and keep a schedule. If you're going to co-author your own books, you need to write lots of books. Because the first one probably will not go viral. But once one does go viral, such as Amanda Hawkins, she wrote quite a few books before she became popular. But once she became popular, then all of her books became popular. So even books she had written, you know, that nobody had noticed originally, suddenly went viral too. So you write lots of books. You might write a series of books like Amanda Hawking did. And then after a while, one takes off and people start buying all of your books. So it really snowballs. You do have to decide, you know, what's my genre? I would like to try various. You know, I wrote a religious book. I have other ideas for religious books. I also have novels that I'm thinking about. So as I approach retirement age, I may write to some more novels. I have academic books I'd like to write and these books on marketing stuff. It's kind of academic. It's not written towards students, it's written towards professionals and would-be professionals. In that case, my book on marketing, for example, is mostly aimed at small entrepreneurs who don't quite understand how to market online. That's kind of my focus of this newest book that I'm working on right now. You might create multiple series, and one series takes off and suddenly another series takes off. But you do have to realize that, especially as a 2.0 author, it may take time. It may be something you need to do as a sidelight to your daytime job. But this is, you know, doesn't cost you anything, and, you know, or not, it just costs you your time primarily. Very few other costs, and so it's something you might want to consider. Other ideas, one book I read suggested that for something like this, for writing a book, you need to organize your ideas, and you need to, what they call, Swiss cheese your work. I don't know if you are familiar with what Swiss cheese is. It's the kind of cheese with lots of holes in it. It's typically a white cheese, and there's holes in it. Actually, in the aging process, the bacteria that goes into Swiss cheese create more gas in it, so it creates holes in the cheese. Well, their version in using the Swiss cheese example, they're saying you just make holes in your project. So you do a little bit at a time. You take one chapter at a time, maybe one idea at a time, and gradually you make enough holes in your cheese, so to speak, that it's all gone. So you have to decide on your goals and your intended market. You decide on your book topic. You maybe next go to your chapter headings, what would my chapters, and so it's, then you start writing one chapter at a time. And you have to rewrite, edit, you maybe send it out to beta readers, friends, relatives, to read it and give you some response and feedback. You need a really good title. The title is really important. And then, you know, do all the things I was talking about to promote it and to achieve success. These are some books by Mark Coker, the founder of Smashwords. You could probably find those. Well, he was talking about in one of his presentations that the one on the left, this is the same book actually, and this he did quite a while ago, but The one on the left he started with and he didn't get any sales. And he paid somebody like $50 to create a cover for him. And so they created this cover on the right and the book took off. And so your cover is really important, as I mentioned before, in your title. And it may be worth paying somebody $50, and he suggests some people are willing to do covers for you. I have a friend who would probably do covers. She's very good at doing, she did a lot of the covers for my charitable books. There are people that can do good covers if you don't feel confident in doing it yourself. This isn't a great cover, I would say, but it's certainly, the one on the right is certainly better than the one on the left. And so it's an important aspect of publishing, especially for 2.0 authors. So these are some of the things that a 2.0 author has to be concerned with. The book title, category, you have to get your ISBN number, which kind of protects, and not just protects it, but helps you market it, because it says, this is a real book. I've been given an ISBN number. Of course, your publication date. Sometimes you put your publication date almost a year in advance. You can do a copyright a year in advance. So in order to make it seem more up to date, you do a copyright for next year, even though you start printing it now. Of course, what name are you going to use? You need to be consistent. You want a short version? Do you want a long version? I've been wrestling with that academically. People kind of push me into Kenneth E. Harvey, my formal name, but I prefer Ken Harvey. And so some of my publications are under Ken Harvey and some are under Kenneth E. Harvey. I have not handled this well. You know, the cover image, what kind of pricing, just pricing is, especially with ebooks, it's almost a science. A book might sell more if you sell it for $9 than if you sell it for $3. Not just you make more, but more people may decide that it must be worth more because you're selling it for $9. And if you sold it at $3, it must not be worth much. They want a good book and it's too cheap. $3 is too cheap. I can kind of illustrate that a little bit, not in a book area, but my daughter had a dog that gave puppies. And so she had like, I don't remember, 10 puppies she had to get rid of. She couldn't, she was living in the city, she couldn't have 10 dogs. And so she was using a free classified, online classified system. And she started offering them for free. And she could not give them away. So she decided, let me try it another way. She started offering them for $50. And she sold them all. So sometimes when you offer something cheap, like a dog, it actually says this isn't worth anything. And so actually setting a price for your books and coming up with an ideal price is a science by itself. Some of these companies like Smashwork can help you. How long should a book be? It mentions here the most, for bestsellers, and this includes novels and stuff, it's 121 words are those that are most successful. So the top 10, 121 words average. When you get down to the top 1,000, then your average goes down. But that also varies. You know, people expect a longer book for a novel. I don't know. Somebody approached me about doing this latest ebook that's only going to be 35 or 40 pages. That's going to be nowhere close to this. 35 or 40 pages, maybe 20,000, 25,000 words. So it's going to be a lot smaller than what's suggested here. So it's kind of a test to see, you know, like I said, I'm going to offer videos with it, video training with it. And so I'm going to see how it works. Somebody wanted me to do it. Somebody approached me about doing it and wants to promote it for me. So I figured, what the heck? I'll give it a try. This is how people discover books, and it's kind of hard to read for you all probably, but it is, and I'm not going to spend much time on it, but maybe look at some of the biggest ones, like 29% Discover books by recommendations from fellow readers online, forums, blogs, message boards. So that's important to know, is that you need to get maybe, you know, give your book free to bloggers, get on forums, go to message boards. So this is a lot of the part, the 2.0 author part that you need to do is figure out how to promote your book. At 18% down here, I look first for my favorite authors. So this kind of goes back to the idea of once you get popular, once you one book, you might have printed or you might have authored 10 books, but once one of them becomes popular, all 10 books will start selling because people do look for authors. So that goes back to that idea. 11%. That's odds and ends. That's miscellaneous. 7%, I browse randomly and then look at reviews. So, you know, that it's kind of hard to, that's probably going to happen, this is going to happen more once you become popular. And I browse book covers. It's, you know, if you haven't made it yet, your cover may not be real obvious to people, may not be exposed to people. So this top one is the most important one for somebody trying to self-author. You need to get into forums and blogs and message boards and social media and all that sort of stuff. Here's some connections with Mark Coker, again, the founder of Smashwords. And if you're interested, like I say, I'm going to do my next book through Smashwords. I have not achieved as much success with Amazon as I'd like to. And as I mentioned, Smashwords actually helps promote it on Amazon and helps you get both on Amazon and Barnes & Noble, and they promote it themselves. And they offer printed versions, and so they offer a lot more services than Amazon. They give you a little more, give their customers more attention, so to speak, from everything I've heard. So I'm going to try it and see how I like it. Okay. I think we have time. I want to, first off, are there any questions? Anything that you'd like to bring up about book authoring? Otherwise, I'm going to leave book authoring. So any questions or comments about what I've been talking about? Because Frederick mentioned, I may kind of make a transition here over to newspapers a little bit. I'm going to talk about presses and about the technology of printing a little bit more. I'm going to refer to the newspaper world and talking about it. So before I go to that, again, are there any questions or comments you would like to make? Anything I can clarify? Was this of any interest to any of you? I don't know. I hope it had some interest to you. Like I say, this is a new age where anybody can become an author. Yeah, but it's, you know, it's challenging. You have to decide you want to do it and that you're willing to invest the time with no certain payback on it. There is a company now that is, well, they're kind of making a joke. I mean, how do I say it? I was tempted to work with them, but it's a company that's headed by a famous author. And basically what he does now is he co-authors books with anybody who pays him like $10,000 or something. You pay him $10,000 and you get to be a co-author of his book. And they assign editors to work with you. But basically it's making him money. And you don't necessarily have to be a good author to become a co-author with him. And they also have some way to guarantee that it'll be a quote-unquote bestseller. So it's kind of it's really a PR thing, and it's their bestseller is not by the New York Times standards. It's the bestseller according to them, I guess. I don't know how they rig the system where they can guarantee it will be a bestseller, but Maybe they just buy so many books that they know that they're just the co-authors buy enough books that they guarantee that for 1 week it'll be a bestseller or something. I don't know. But they have some sort of system where it's just garbage, frankly. And so I wasn't going to pay them $10,000 to co-author a book on that basis. But the point that they were making that is valid, I think, and that is there are some advantages to becoming an author. As you become an author, you can put it on your CV, your resume. You can go out and get speaking engagements based on the fact that you're an author. It's definitely better if you can show them a printed book. You say, hey, this is my printed book on this subject. You know, I'd like to talk to your group about it. So you can get speaking engagements to help promote your book and gain some credibility along the way. So there are some PR purposes for writing a book, even if it doesn't sell very much. I wouldn't go so far as to pay somebody to make it a so-called bestseller, even though I see, you know, it's an interesting approach. Let me put it that way. So if there's no question, I'm going to go to a different PowerPoint. I'm going to start uploading it right now. But do feel free to ask questions or make comments as you would as I bring this up. This is a daily newspaper I used to work at, and I just want to kind of introduce you to the daily newspaper from give you a tour of it, help you give you a little better idea of what a daily newspaper in America looks like, but at the same time, talk about some of the technology and about the printing technology. That's a large part of this PowerPoint as well. So I'm going to, again, hide that. So here I sometimes make this part of my media and PR management or media management, PR management class to kind of give the background of what a newspaper operation is like. So this is the Tri-City Herald in Kennewick, Washington. Nice, large, they were very profitable until recently. And now with the movement of advertising to the internet, very few newspapers in America are profitable anymore. But they were making enough money. They built this really nice building. I can't remember when they built it. It's after I left, actually. So 1995, 96, maybe. You know, about 10, that'd be 20 years ago. Maybe it was even after that. But anyway, I'm not going into a lot of detail, but they... Herald's been around quite a while, since 1947, so it's getting close to its, what would that be? Well, it's basically 3 years older than me. So it's almost 70 years old. Just an idea of a newspaper organization. Real quickly, the president publisher, typically at top. You have an executive editor overseeing the news part of organization, frequently a managing editor under him. This is the organization of this daily newspaper that was kind of, would be considered a mid-sized newspaper in America, about 50,000 circulation. An HR, human resources director, ad manager for both selling and creating the ads. He might have under him or separately a classified ad manager. Classified ads are starting to disappear in daily newspapers. Classified ads are things like Help Wanted or My Daughter Selling Her Puppies, that sort of thing, selling your car that you want to buy a new car, so you're selling your old car. That would all come in this classified section where you just buy a really small ad for that. A lot of that is going online to free services. And so about 80% of the revenue that newspapers used to get from classified ads has disappeared. It's gone. They typically have a circulation manager that's in charge of distributing the newspaper. In America, the daily newspapers are mostly by subscription, and they're mostly delivered to the doorstep. They go right to your door, your apartment door, your house door, on your doorstep. Press manager overseeing the printing, obviously. IT, the technology director, especially in this day and age, to oversee all the technology aspects of the newspaper. So this is a typical organization of leadership in a newspaper nowadays, particularly, I'd say it's fairly uniform, I guess, with bigger newspapers too. They just have more people underneath these people. Within the newsroom, I mentioned the executive editor kind of oversees the entire operation, doesn't do much, just kind of quality control if nothing else. Managing editor takes more control over the day-to-day operations, as his name would suggest. Metro or city editor, again, this more reflects a mid-sized newspaper. It gets much more complicated with the New York Times or the Washington Post or somebody like that. But most newspapers aren't that big. Most newspapers are 50,000 or less, as the newspaper that I worked at. So there's a metro editor and city editor who oversee the local reporters. So they're more interested in the content. And when the reporters bring them their stories, they may do some copy editing, but that's not their job. That's the job of the news editor and his team of copy editors and so forth. So he's mostly looking at content. Did you ask all the right questions? Did you get all the information you needed? And so forth. And they may assign out beats. They assign out specific stories to the reporters and stuff like that. Feature editor would oversee certain feature, like in the case of the Tri-City Herald, we had always printed four sections at the time. So there was the front section, which was the front page included the best stories from on any subject, could even have a sports story if there was a big enough sports story for the front section, but typically not, but usually the best international, best national, and best local stories all went on the front page. But we also then had a sports page, and so the sports editor oversaw the sports page. We typically had a local section, and that was the metro editor would oversee the local section. It was mostly local and regional news. And we had a feature section that would change every day. So one day on Wednesdays was when they sold grocery store ads. And so they would have a food section and maybe recipes and stuff like that for their feature section. On Fridays, they sold a lot of advertising for entertainment. And so the front page for the feature section was about entertainment. And the feature editor oversaw basically all of those different feature sections on different days. Mentioned the sports editor, that's obvious. The news editor oversaw the copy editing functions and some of the related functions. He oversaw, for example, all the copy editors, and he would receive the stories from the metro editor, and he would assign them to certain pages and give them to a copy editor to do the copy editing, the fine-tune editing, spelling, grammar, all that stuff, write the headline, and electronically nowadays design the page. The wire editor, typically underneath the news editor, I served as wire editor and copy editor at the same time. For a lot of time, I was at the daily paper. I had to, you know, review the 1,000 or so stories that came in every day from the different press services, the Associated Press, New York Times Service, Washington Post, LA Times Services, and decide which were the most important stories to fit in the space that we had available, and also make suggestions in what we call the front page meeting to the executive editor and managing editor and the other editors gathered there as to what should go on the front page. And otherwise I would fill up other pages the news editor would allocate to me and I would then give them to the copy editors. Photo editor, of course, and graphics editor do maps and info, various information graphics, so forth. I may not have time to get all the way through this. We may pick it up next week. Obviously, you need customer service. And so they had people sitting at the front desk to greet people as they came in. I'm going to skip through a lot of this stuff. This is kind of a model of the building before they actually built it. This was owned by McClatchy, which is now the biggest newspaper chain in America. It was started by the first publisher was this Glenn Lee, and then they sold it to McClatchy in 1979. I joined it in 1986. Moving on. This is the managing editor at at the time that I did these pictures anyway. Like I said, it's about 50,000 circulation at the time. They made a $9 million investment just in this building. They were making lots of money. And then suddenly they weren't, along with most other newspapers. They're now hurting for revenue. Most newspapers in America have lost, the whole entire industry, newspaper industry in America has lost about 60% of its advertising revenue. So it's hurting real bad. And that's not going to get better. Everything's going online, and newspapers have not figured out how to make money online. So they're hurting. They need customer service, so they have a bunch of people they hire to just answer phone calls, whether it may be about putting in a classified ad, it may be about their getting their subscription delivered to their house properly, whatever. Circulation area, particularly overseas, the distribution of all the newspapers in a 90-mile radius. Again, they go house to house. They have to hire lots of contracted people to deliver these newspapers house to house. So they may have literally hundreds of kids starting from age 10 or 11 or 12 that they pay to deliver house to house, part of their overall function, quite complicated. My kids used to deliver newspapers for the paper. The circulation department does make a lot of money for them, but the circulation only is expected to cover the cost of distribution. They don't really expect to make a profit on what they charge for a subscription. Advertising makes most of the money, so advertising sales is vital. And as I said, 60% has disappeared, and so that's a problem. IT, this guy was the head of the IT department. Some older computers when I took this, so this was in 2000 and something, so it's only maybe 12, 13 years ago when I made this. They were still using some fairly old technology, and obviously they needed to update. This is the newsroom. This was the executive editor, Ken Robertson at the time, sports editor. And they at the time had a staff of 46 people writing, gathering the news, writing the stories, editing it, and producing it overall. So it wasn't a small operation, but it doesn't compare to like the Washington Post at its largest before it started losing advertising, had 900 people in their news department. Well, that's huge compared to a mid-sized daily like the Tri-City Herald. New York Times maybe still has 900 people. They have a huge staff and huge circulation compared to this. Reporters like this one gathering the news. And then as they do their stories, they turn over the city desk for the first review for content. I mentioned Rick Larson, the managing editor at the time. Lori Williams was the city editor, but now I think she is now the managing editor, so she's been promoted. And city editor again is mostly reviews for the content, and then they make small edits, but they return it to the reporter if they want the reporter to do some additional reporting or make some major changes. And only then does it go to the copy desk to be put in the newspaper and to do the fine-tuning and the spelling and grammar sort of checks. Bob Brody here was still there last year, still their photo editor. They mentioned here they're producing about 600 digital photos a day, of which only 20 or 30 would be published. So photographers are some of the first to be laid off during a tight budget time like it is right now. A very important part because newspapers are becoming more visual at the same time. So Reporters are doing more photography nowadays in American newspapers. The graphics editor, again, doing maps and other infographics. One of the other copy editors, Bill Ward, who's been there for ages, he's now retired. We do electronic pagination. Editorial page I mentioned last week is a totally different function for the news section. The editorial page editor and writers do not write news, and news writers do not write at least a mid to large size daily. They're totally separate operations. One is about opinion, and one is about news gathering. They try to keep them separate. So this was an editorial page editor. Once the copy desk electronically prepares the pages, they send them to electronically to the printing department. The Herald became fully paginated in 1994, and was one of the first newspapers in America to become fully paginated electronically. Before that, it was a lot of the work was done manually. You took a picture of it. I won't go into that right now. I just wanted to. So this is produced it electronically, then they make what's called a plate, aluminum plate, that will be put on the press itself. The pre-press work was a lot more labor intensive previously, but now it's being done in a machine like this, so there's much less work outside of labor by real people, so to speak. They use a laser beam to, in essence, etch the image of the page onto a metal plate, and then deliver it to the press. This is a model of the press. It's three stories high. And then again, this is for just a medium size. I've been in the New York Times press room, and they have dozens. They put out 900,000 papers a day, and they have to do it within a 3 or 4 hour period of time. And so they have dozens of presses that are bigger than this. But even this one is three stories high. The rolls of paper, illustrated down at the bottom, weigh a half a ton, about 1,000 pounds. And they can print at a rate of 70,000 entire newspapers an hour, during an hour's period of time. In theory, that's the rate they print. Here are the rolls of paper going into the press. It gets printed on both sides, just rolls up and gets printed and then cut and folded later. So again, I'm kind of pointing out here, as I mentioned earlier, getting this all set up is the expensive part. Once you hit the button and it starts printing, that's the inexpensive part. So the rolls of paper roll up and go. They have to, have all these paper, all the rolls of paper waiting. The Herald uses, at the time, they used about 20 to 30 of these rolls every day, each one weighing half a ton, in order to print their daily newspaper. So it took a lot of paper. So you can figure it out. So it'd be somewhere between 10 to 15 tons of paper went into their newspaper every day. Finishing up, I know we're about out of time. This is just their warehouse with all these rolls of paper. They can't afford to run out, and so they have to stockpile it in their warehouse. Again, this is kind of the second level of the press. So you can see the ink and stuff is being applied here. Right now he's actually cleaning the press before they turn it on to print the next edition. But the paper that you saw, the roll up at the bottom, will come up and go in the middle of this press unit and be printed on both sides. So these rollers, these plates are put on these cylinders, and the cylinders go around and around and around, around very quickly and print both sides simultaneously. They make so much noise, it sounds like you're standing by a freight train. And so they now let people go into a shielded room to protect themselves, or they wear ear protection. Sorry, the telephone is ringing in the background. I'm going to ignore that. This is a small press here. Obviously, this is one that's only, you know, just not hardly as tall as, just a little bit taller than a man is. But it kind of shows what happens in the big press too. The paper comes up, rolls through one. It may go down and roll through another one to get a different color of ink, and go through another press unit to get another color of ink. To get full color, it has to go through four, has four colors added to it. Magenta, which is kind of reddish. Cyan, which is bluish. Black, of course, and yellow. And those four colors make all other colors. And so they add all those colors together in the print process to make a full color photo, and everything has to be just right. And so they actually waste a lot of paper in the printing process. Because they may be running it for 15 or 20 minutes trying to get everything lined up. As you see here, that this is the yellow being printed onto this roll of paper, and then it'll go get another color, the cyan color, and the next one, and so forth. So again, that's called a web press. It webs through the different print units. Again, this is a smaller press here, still owned by the same company, but for small jobs, not for their daily newspaper. So you see how it webs through all the different units. And then it comes out, and they cut and fold it and give you a final product. Of course, the bigger press goes much faster. I guess it says here 60,000 hours, it says 70,000, but they actually slow it down. They don't go full speed, and they have to stop it once in a while to change the paper. So in the truth, it takes about more like 2 hours to print 50,000 papers, just because they have to stop and start, and they go slower. They have to run a bunch of papers just to get everything lined up properly. They throw a lot of paper away. It goes out into another section where they put insert pre-printed circulars into the paper, and it's done again mechanically. They use suction cups and stuff to pick up a pre-printed flyer, a grocery flyer, for example, and stick inside the newspaper in this mechanical process. So here's some pre-prints that are going to get put inside the newspaper using that kind of equipment you just saw. Here's another piece of equipment, again, using vacuum, suction, and stuff like that to put the pre-prints into the newspaper. And then it rolls out to the distributors. The distributor gets put into vans like these and taken out. You know, starting as soon as they start coming off the press, they start running them out to the distributors. They drop off bundles of newspapers at, in this case, 353 different locations. For a bigger newspaper, it'd be more locations. This is just 50,000 circulation newspapers, opposed to the New York Times 900,000. But they, you know, you see how complicated it is. 88% of their newspapers go to individuals to their front door. The rest are paid at vending machines and stuff. And they have 9 district managers overseeing 500 carrier routes, 70% of which are kids ages 10 to 17. And that's like herding rabbits. That's a very frustrating job, trying to make sure that 10-year-olds are doing their job right. Then people call in and complain if they don't get their newspaper by 7 a.m. In fact, they're told to call and complain. And you see all these waste bins where they put all that extra paper to recycle. So that's a newspaper operation in a nutshell, but it also talks about the press. We are out of time now, so I'll stop there. Some of you probably already left. But thank you, and we'll see you next week. And if there are any questions, I'll stay around for a few minutes if anybody has any further questions. Are you even still there? I haven't seen anything. Okay, good. You're still alive. I was thought you maybe got hit by a bomb or something. No comments. Okay, well, thank you. Okay, I'll take a look at your email. And yes, we do need to make sure everybody has a chapter to present. And so hopefully that email includes that. We'll get you scheduled. And so you can begin sharing your presentations perhaps next week, because actually I believe somebody is due to present soon. So thank you again, and we will see you next week. If there's any questions, again, I will stay for a few minutes. Thank you a lot. I know most of you are leaving right now. I'm just going to play that video to make it part of this. I should have turned it on earlier to make it part of this recorded version, but I'm going to go ahead and play it now, and so that it's part of this this recording.
Ever since people started recording information, there's been a need to duplicate it.
Very nice work, Brother Dominic.
Thank you.
Very nice. Now, I would like 500 more sets.
Brother Dominic, how are you?
You do the job for me.
This is a 92-100 duplication system, unlike anything we've ever made. Feeds cycles originals. It has a computerized program which controls the entire system. It can duplicate, reduce, and assemble a virtually limitless number of complete sets, and does it all at an incredible 2 pages per second.
Three sets, brother. The 500 sets you asked for.
It's a miracle.
The Xerox 9200 duplicating system, unlike anything we've ever made, feeds and cycles originals, has a computerized program that controls the entire system, can duplicate, reduce, and assemble a virtually limitless number of complete sets, and does it all at an incredible 2 pages per second.
3 sets, Father. The 500 sets you asked for.
It's a miracle.
Okay, well, hopefully that is now part of the final video for those that, but I also post it on Facebook anyway. Okay.